Going live. Got it. So let me pull up my Facebook on my phone. I will be monitoring chat for anyone that wants to check us out while we're live. If you have questions, please enter those in Facebook chat. I'll be watching those, and I'll make sure to ask those of Ruth at the end. But I am Jacob Del Rio at the Edwardsville Public Library, and we're here for another wonderful collaboration between Lovejoy Library at SIUE at Edwardsville and Edwardsville Public Library. We're here with another virtual presentation. In this case, we have Therese Dickman, Fine Arts Librarian at Lovejoy Library, who has been working there since 1984, and she's cared dearly for their music collection and their music department, among other fine arts. So Therese, thank you for your expertise on tonight's subject, which is Ruth Slenczynska, her musical life at SIUE. Therese, I will turn it over to you, and you've got a PowerPoint to share with us.
Yes, I do. Thank you, Jacob, for inviting me to give this presentation. And I thought if I was to do a presentation about Ruth, and as long as Ruth was willing and able, that it would be only natural and appropriate that I reach out and ask her to take part in this as well. So I very much appreciate. Hello, Ruth.
Hello, Therese. It's delightful to be with you. You were the other Polish lady that I had to speak with at SIUE.
That's right. My maiden name is Zaski. You know, one of the short Polish names there you'll find.
And I was at your wedding, remember?
Yes, you were. Yes, you were. That's one of those Edwardsville connections. So I'm very, very happy that you and your husband were able to attend there. And also with you is Dr. Shelley Mormon-Stallman. And you are there with her. So just so people know that she may speak from time to time as well, perhaps at the end. All right, I'm going to share my screen. Most of these images that I'll share today are taken from the Ruth Slenczynska Collection. I first came to SIUE in 1984, and I met Ruth Slenczynska, her, shortly afterwards, and she was near the end of her time as artist in residence, where she was working full time on campus. And so before she retired, she donated some substantial materials about her early childhood and her career, musical career. So I'll share some glimpses of those here in the presentation today. And there will be opportunities for Ruth to comment about these some of these things. And we'll focus, I'm gonna do a little bit of an introduction about what she did before she came to SIUE, and then we'll focus at that point, most of that time, remaining time, on her Edwardsville, particularly SIUE, Southern Illinois University Edwardsville years. Okay, so I put my Polish name in there for you, Ruth. And I am also an associate professor at SIUE, so I do enjoy working with students in a teaching capacity as well. All right. So I love this photo of Ruth, and if you'll notice, her name was Ruth Slenczynska at that point in time. And she was about 4 years old at this stage. Her father here, Joseph. Ruth, do you want to say something about you and your sisters and family briefly?
That was our passport picture when we went to Europe. I was 5 years old at the time. My sister Helen sitting on my mother's lap, and Gloria is on top there looking it over. And my father, mother, the three of us had one passport picture, and this was it. This is when we first went to Europe.
Right. And before then, your father had aspired for you to become a musician right from the get-go. And so he started teaching you, I understand. And at age 4, you gave your first recital.
Yes. And I gave several other recitals after that. I played in Columbia Theater in San Francisco, and a lot of people became interested in me because there was a whole page in, I think it was the San Francisco Examiner newspaper at the time, showing prodigies, and I was one of several prodigies that included people like Yehudi Menuhin, the violinist, and Ruggiero Ricci, another violinist, and Grisha Gulabov, who was also a violinist. I was the only pianist and the only girl. And so I guess I got a little special notice because of that.
And this program, this was your farewell recital program from, because you were born in Sacramento, California.
That isn't Sacramento, that's San Francisco.
No, I know this particular, you're right. You're totally right. This program was given in San Francisco. And you, after this recital, you were headed to Curtis Institute, right?
I think I went to Curtis Institute before that recital.
This recital is being given with the approval of Joseph Hoffman, who upon playing recently in San Francisco was so amazed at the maturity of this child's musical understanding. He not only awarded her a scholarship at Curtis Institute, but also expressed his intention of giving Ruth the benefit of his personal instruction when he is in Philadelphia. Yes. This will be Ruth's only concert in San Francisco prior to leaving for Philadelphia. And this is the one she played for Mr. Hoffman.
Yes.
So, here is a photo of Joseph Hoffman. And this is what he had inscribed on this photo: to a sweet and very gifted girl, Ruth Julia Slenczynska, with best wishes. So then you went to Europe to study shortly thereafter. And how long did you study at the Curtis Institute?
Just a short time. I don't know exactly how long, but I'll always remember those days because it was the one time in my whole life that I was really treated like a talented student rather than as a little girl or a prodigy, but like a talented musician, because there were other little kids who were talented musicians also. And I enjoyed that very much. One of my friends was Samuel Barber, and I think he gave me the best piano lesson of my whole life. I always remember Sam Barber because he is the person who told me that I would be playing many concerts in my life, and to consider the idea that when I walked on stage, I should present the audience with how beautiful the music is, not how well I played. In other words, he told me, don't be one of these show-off kids. Be a musician. Make your audience listen to the music, and you'll do all right. And I tell myself that lesson every single time I walk on stage, even now.
Wonderful.
But I made lots of other little friends at Curtis as well.
All right. So when your family went to Europe then, mm-hmm. you studied with Alfred Cortot, for instance, who was a French composer and pianist, conductor.
Yes.
You also studied with Nadia Boulanger.
That's right. She gave me my theory in harmony. And before I went to Nadia Boulanger, though, I had a foundation in theory and in harmony as well. The earliest ones were in California, actually, so that I was more than just a pianist. I was studying music and the backgrounds of music and music history and the theory of harmony and all of this.
And it all makes you that much more prepared to, as you perform, yes, too, to understand the music.
Yeah.
I included this photo of Gunnar Johansson, which is one of my favorites, but he was also an artist in residence, which is why I thought it was appropriate for him to be in this presentation. He was a Danish pianist, and he moved to and became a citizen of the United States. And he went to Wisconsin, right?
Well, he was probably my first really professional teacher. And he's the one who thought I should study with Egon Patry, because he had studied with Egon Patry. And when we first went to Europe, Mr. Johansson thought I should go first to Germany and study with Egon Patry and get some foundation in technique. Because, of course, that age I didn't have a technique. I was pretty young.
And then I wanted to include this photo because you were obviously maturing, getting older, and that's about a stage when the audiences weren't as quite as receptive, and you just needed time to grow up. I mean, from what I was reading and so on. So it wasn't much after this that you stopped concertizing as a child, mm-hmm, prodigy, and went to school at Berkeley. And you met someone at Berkeley. Who is this?
I don't know.
Actually, it's George Bourne.
That's George Bourne?
That's
not
what
a
it
good
said.
Picture.
Yeah, that's an early photo. And you know him from other.
That's not a good picture of him.
Oh, I'm so sorry. There weren't many photos. There was a wedding photo I could have selected too, but it had more people in it. So,
yes.
Okay, so this is George Bourne, not his best picture, but in what year were you married? Do you remember?
I don't remember. That's so long ago.
Yeah, and there we have better stories coming ahead with your second in your marriage in Edwardsville. Okay, so. Here your name is showing sincerely, Ruth Slenczynska. This is before 1951. Mm-hmm. And this is after 1951. This is 1953. Notice the difference. And why was 1951 kind of an important year for you? No?
Well, there's a big difference. The later photograph shows me after I received a contract with a New York manager for the first time. And I was full of hope in those days. I had a contract to go on tour with Arthur Fiedler and the Boston Pops, and I was going to play every night of the week and two performances on Saturdays and Sundays. And I had to have four concertos in my fingers. And that first year was a great success and was renewed three times. I had 4 years under Arthur Fiedler, which means 16 concertos that I learned how to play in public and well. So
that's awesome. And then that was also that your father passed away. And shortly after that, you changed your name to Ruth Slenczynska.
Yes.
You legally changed your name.
I changed it because I was a lady pianist and I was proud of being a Polish lady pianist.
Yes.
So I changed from using my father's name, which is I, ends in I, to the A ending. I was a personality by myself.
Yep. Yes, indeed. Okay, and here at this point, now, this was in 1957. Of course, you can see your name here. And Forbidden Childhood is your autobiography. And I know you had a Lewis Van Coley collaborating with you.
Yes, he was a fine writer. He wrote for some newspaper in New York, and he also wrote biographies of other musical personalities. I don't remember who exactly, but several other personalities. And then he wrote mine, and Forbidden Childhood was the name of it. I didn't like the name, but that's the name they gave it. And I think the reason a lot of people bought this book was not me at all, but the fact that they had on their staff a young man named Andy Warhol, who was very, very talented. And I think people bought the book in order to get the Andy Warhol sketches that were in the book. Even the front, the shape of the piano, is an Andy Warhol creation.
That's right.
Yeah.
So another interesting connection with the arts. Okay, and these are just a few scenes showing you performed at Town Hall in 1933, and then later, 25 years later, in your Silver Jubilee in 1958. You know, so that was pretty remarkable in itself. Here are some other images from that time period. And this shows how you, they would shorten the stool, but the pedals were the same as. Wait, how was it when you were performing as a child in order to reach the pedals? What did they do?
Well, you see, they built a box, and the box had two pedals on it, one for the right foot, one for the left, that fitted over the piano pedals so that I could use the pedals in that way. I couldn't reach the floor, but I could reach this box and use the pedals. But for going on tour, the Baldwin Piano Company, built special legs that were 6 inches shorter than the normal piano legs. And wherever I went, this box of legs was sent so that they could be attached to the piano on which I played so that I could rest my heels on the floor, and the piano was 6 inches lower. The keyboard was 6 inches lower.
That was very accommodating of them to do that. But as much as you were performing, you know, that had to make a difference for you. Now I've included this picture of Arthur Rubinstein because, as you mentioned earlier, you were given an offer back in 1953. In 1951, you were teaching in Burlingame, California, and someone heard you practicing a Bach piece and invited you to perform at the Carmel Bach Festival.
Yes.
And that was a turning point in your career also, wasn't it?
Well, I wasn't sure I wanted to play that. I didn't think I had the talent at that time to be able to walk out on stage and play. And that's why I had quit playing, because I thought, I know music well enough to teach little people and young people how to play. And I had enough training to be able to teach them, but I don't think I have the kind of talent to walk on stage by myself and perform. So this person who persuaded me to try it out in Carmel, California. And Mother Superior, who was my boss at the school where I taught, College of Our Lady of Mercy, Mother Superior said, just think of all the students you'll get if you're a success. This is good, and we'll all pray for you. So she was very much for it. And with all of this going on, I couldn't say no. So I went on stage and I played. I played a Bach program and it went very well. And the newspapers just gave me accolades. And in fact, the critic from the San Francisco Examiner, whose name is Alexander Freed at that time, telephoned me and asked if I would be willing to try out for being a soloist with the San Francisco Summer Series, which was being conducted by the famous Arthur Fiedler from Boston. They had hired him to conduct the San Francisco Symphony that summer. And so I said yes, and I wrote down my list of concertos, and I played for Mr. Fiedler, and Mr. Fiedler chose two of my concertos to play in San Francisco. He chose the Mendelssohn Capriccio Brillante and also the Liszt Totentanz. They are two contrasting pieces, and they hadn't been played in San Francisco. And so he thought that that would be a good idea. And I played, and it was a huge success. And Mr. Fiedler said, you should come next spring to play with us in Boston. So I thought, my, that's going to be fun. I'd love to go and play with the Boston Symphony. And I kept in touch with him, and I went to Boston, and I played the Totentanz of Liszt. I remember my mother came to that concert, too, and she was real proud of me, and it went very well. And backstage, after that concert, Mr. Fiedler said, we are contemplating taking the Boston Pops on tour, and we want a piano soloist. How would you like to be that piano soloist? And I said, oh my gosh, I'd love to do that, but I'm scared, because if I took that job, I'd have to quit my teaching position. And I need my teaching position. This is how I live. It's because I teach. And so he said, well, think about it, but not more than 3 weeks, because we are looking for a soloist and we can't hold this open. So I said, yes, I understand. So I wrote to Mr. Rubinstein. Now, Mr. Rubinstein, I knew from Paris. And the way I knew him is because in Paris, I had participated in the concerts that Madame de Rothschild gave on Sunday afternoons in the summertime. And so did Mr. Rubinstein. So did Alfred Cortot, who was my teacher, who was responsible for bringing me to the attention to the Baroness. And so I knew Mr. Rubinstein. He was a fun-loving type. And he's the person who looked at my hand at first, and he said, you have perfect piano hands. They are just as square. They're as big across as they are long. You see, I have a kind of a square hand. He said, those are strong piano hands. They're small, but they're strong. You should be a good pianist. So I remembered with a lot of affection this fun-loving Mr. Rubinstein, and I knew he lived in Southern California. I lived in the San Francisco region. And so I wrote to him and I said, would you listen to me play? And so he very kindly answered me. He said, yes, you can come to my house at such and such an address, and I'll be glad to listen to you. I went there, and he said, well, tell me about your repertoire. He said, this all focuses on what your background is. And I told him what I had, and he asked me to play a Mozart sonata and a Beethoven sonata. And do you know any Chopin etudes? I said, yes, I know the whole book, all 24. And he just chose which ones he wanted. I played them for him. I played for about 4 hours. He kept asking for different things. And then he said, well, now what can I do for you? And I said, tell me if you think I should quit my job and take this opportunity of traveling with Arthur Fiedler, because if I quit my job, I quit having an income. He said, quit the job. You'll love playing. You'll be a huge success, and you won't want to teach anymore after 10 concerts, he said. So he's the one who's responsible for me taking that great leap. And I went on tour with Arthur Fiedler, and that lasted for 4 years. And then
you performed over 300 concerts with him in just those 4 years. So it was pretty strenuous. Every weekend you were doing multiple concerts, I understand.
I was playing every night of the week and twice on Saturday and twice on Sunday. Yeah. So that was a pretty big deal. And then it was a happy relationship, though. Afterwards, I played several times again with Mr. Fiedler. He was always welcome to come to Boston and play. And it just grew and grew and grew like Topsy.
Yeah. All right, well, let's go on because we have more to do. We want to get to Edwardsville yet. I'm setting the stage for Edwardsville. If my computer will work.
Because I traveled so much. There was one year when I went to Europe to play. Then I went to South Africa. And I had that very, very busy 3 weeks there. Then I came back to New York and went straight to South America. And when I came back from that South American tour, I had played so many concerts, so many, not just in the evening, but morning, noon, and night, and afternoons. I woke up about 2 days after I returned home to New York. And my first thought is, what concert do I play tonight? What program? And I wasn't well. And I called up the doctor who was on the second floor of the building where I lived in New York. He was a friend of mine too. And I said, you know, I think you better take a look at me. I'm not well. And I just came back from tour and this isn't right. And he said, you better not play for a year. He said, you have the beginning of an ulcer in your stomach.
That was in 1963 when that happened,
yes.
Right?
And he said, you'd better take at least a year off concertizing. So I thought, oh my goodness, how am I going to live? So
how does Lloyd Blakely fit into that picture?
Well, that's the very next step. He telephoned me. I didn't know him from Adam, but at that time he was searching for an artist in residence to live in Edwardsville. I never heard of Edwardsville, but he told me what he was looking for and was I interested in it. So I said, well, I have to have a look. I have to know what this is all about. I've never done anything like that. And I thought he was, you know, joking. But here he had this picture of a university going up in the midst of nowhere in the little town. I'd never lived in a little town in my life. And I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't know how to drive. And I said, well, this would be a completely new life for me. He said, well, you could just come for a year and see how you like it. And that's how I came to Edwardsville.
I found this photo, and it's for me who came 20 years later when the buildings were in place. This is just amazing to see how that's that's Peck Hall and Lovejoy Library that were going up at that time.
Yes.
It's so different. And what a bold, courageous move for you to do,
yes,
given the past history that we just went through. I mean, that's incredible. But thank you for doing that. So I found this flyer, and it actually mentions you as artist in residence of Southern Illinois University Edwardsville campus at Alton, Illinois. And in those earliest years, SIUE was Southern Illinois University Edwardsville was under construction. So they had purchased the former Shurtleff College in Alton, Illinois. So it's my understanding that that's where you taught, and that's you lived in Alton initially.
That's right.
And this is a photo from the Muse yearbook. So this is the first photo I see of you in the yearbook. And these three students apparently were former students of yours in New York. And they were interviewed on a radio program. So I like that photo of you. And then the photo below is of John Kendall. John Kendall of Suzuki Music fame, also on campus. And he came in 1963. So he was there just a little before you. So the two of you were quite some just amazing faculty for this young fledgling university just getting started.
Well, I think that Mr. Blakely was very eager to have a university in the Midwest that would do for the Midwestern people who were interested in music what Juilliard did in New York. He wanted it to be a really fine music school that would develop fine musicians and be an attraction to young people who are interested in music. I think we succeeded.
Yes, and that was that early generation of those at SIUE were pioneers. They were quite visionary and forward thinking about what the university could be.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm trying to get my computer to advance here.
Edwardsville, well, the first thing that was, I had to buy a car, learn how to drive. And that was the big thing in my life then. And I had to live in a small town and learn how to get around. That, I think, is the building where I had my first piano studio. It was on the Alton campus rather than the Edwardsville campus. That's where I taught. Alton Camp, SIUE, sure.
And one of your early students from 1964, Pat Deneff, just brought me these photos the other day, this week. And so I said, do you mind if I share these, use these in this program? And she said, oh, please do. So she said these were the steps that she went up to go to your studio. She'd go through this door, and your studio was upstairs, right?
That's right.
So which of these windows did you look out from your studio? Do you remember?
Well, if you turn, see the red building?
Yes.
On the side of that red building was where my studio was. And they had a nice grand piano in there. And then eventually a second grand piano went in there, and that's where I worked. And that's where my students came. And I was there, I think, for about 2 years before the Edwardsville campus was ready. And then I bought my very first house. I was so thrilled with it, to own my own home, actually. So there I was.
Now, I think this first picture was of the auditorium building, and that's where you would practice, right, sometimes?
Yes, in Edwardsville. And when I went to Edwardsville, then by that time I started making friends, and one of my friends was the wife of a history professor. Her name was Rita Weiss, her husband, Dr. Weiss. That's one of my students in Edwardsville.
Yes.
That's Stan Ford. And he is now retiring from teaching in Salzburg. He taught there all of his life. That was his first big job, and he stayed there and became quite a personality as a teacher and accompanist, Mozart specialist. Yes. He was so talented, that boy. I enjoyed working with him, and I trained him in Mozart particularly. He had the sweetest sound, wonderful touch. You wouldn't think that a boy who's more than 6 feet tall would have such sweetness in his hands when he touched the piano. It was quite a lovely experience to watch him grow and develop and get that job in Salzburg. He got first to Florida, and there he found someone who taught him the language, the German language of poetry, so that he could play for German singers. And it seems that when you are an accompanist, you have to mouth the words so that the singer can follow your mouth. And he learned how to do that. And I remember one of my New York friends, William Warfield, came to Edwardsville once, and he had to give a workshop for us. And he said, I have a German Fräulein that I should bring with me. And I said, oh, you won't need to. I've got a student who can take care of that. You'll be able to save money if you just come by yourself. You won't need your German Fräulein. And I'll always remember when William Warfield came, and I called Stan to come to my office, and he walked in, and the smile on Bill Warfield's face was so big and so happy to see a big black boy. And then they went through a few songs, and he was so happy to have him, and they worked together just beautifully. And of course, with Bill to recommend him, he started going places. He started playing for other singers from the Met, and he was
He's done very well and continues to have a very successful career. And works very hard at it.
He's retiring now after 25 years with teaching at Salzburg and playing with some of the best singers all over Europe. So
another chapter ahead for him coming up.
Yeah.
And you know, that's another thing that was, as I was reading, you attracted students from all throughout the world. But what about some other, this is another, but where are some of the countries that students came from during that period?
Uh-huh. Well, the Mississippi River Festival took place in the outdoors every summer. And that was not on campus.
It was on campus, but it was kind of just beyond the perimeter of the, it wasn't on the core of the campus. It was as you were heading north from campus. And it had its own natural amphitheater. Go ahead.
That's the San Francisco Symphony with Slotkin. And Leonard Slotkin was an excellent conductor. He came from Hollywood people and had been with music all his life too. And then he conducted in St. Louis, got the St. Louis Symphony. And I played with him, a lot. I played with him not only in St. Louis, but in Chicago. We went to Grant Park, and we played at least half a dozen times in Grant Park in Chicago. we had a good time together.
Wonderful. Yeah, and here's
Slotkin.
Yeah, after one of those MRF Mississippi River Festival performances. It could get pretty hot out there in the summertime.
Yes. Well, of course, heat doesn't bother a musician. We just play. Yeah. Well, that's a pretty good program. My goodness, look at
that. Yes, this is from a performance you gave in 1970, in October, and this was for the 200th anniversary of the birth of Beethoven. And we've just gone through another anniversary year for Beethoven just in 2020. Mm-hmm. So that's why I thought I'd include this one in there.
That's a good program. I'm proud of that. Yeah.
All right. So while you were teaching, you were also contributing articles to the Piano Quarterly.
Yes.
Here you were featured on the cover, actually. And then you also contributed to Keyboard Magazine during those years.
Yes.
Do you have anything you want to say about those?
I knew that people who worked for universities were expected to write for different magazines if they wanted to. And so I did. I just normally did. My husband contributed. He didn't. He contributed in his field, and I always felt, you know, a little bit inferior because I didn't. And then all at once, they decided to publish some of the things that I wrote, too. I nearly went to St. Petersburg in Russia because I wrote an article about pedaling in connection with the Prokofiev Visio Fugiti, and I presented ways of pedaling in these pieces, and I never expected to get an answer from Russia about them. And so I naturally took it to the Russian professor. I didn't know a word of Russian. And we started a correspondence about different ways of pedaling, and this particular person also was interested in pedaling, but he had a different way of a different approach, and so we had a lot to talk about. And he offered me an opportunity to come for a semester on an exchange basis, and I was thrilled to pieces to think of going all the way to St. Petersburg and having an opportunity to teaching all these talented kids. And I came home and told my husband. My husband put both his hands on my shoulders. He said, "You're not going." That's the first time my husband ever told me, never stopped me from doing something I wanted to do. Why?
All right, so now you just mentioned your
husband.
You're
not, what?
You just mentioned your husband, so yes. we didn't cover. How did you meet your husband, Jim?
How did
Dr.
I meet?
Dr. James Kerr, yes.
Yes. Well,
that goes way back to 1965, doesn't it?
Yes, well, I was married in 67, actually. But in 1965, I met him through a history couple I made friends with, Rita Weiss and her husband, and they invited me, and Jim Kerr was there, and we talked. He took me home at that time. Now, I should tell you, when I was once, I played in Southern California, a person came backstage to talk to me because he loved music, an older person. His name was Clifton Webb, and I hadn't the faintest idea who Clifton Webb was, but he told me that he came to New York every year in order to go to the opera, and would I be interested in going to the opera with him? And I said, well, it has to be at a time when I'm in town, because the opera always plays during a time when I could be concertizing in South America or someplace. But so we kept in touch, and Clifton Webb became a person with whom I looked forward to going to the opera with, and he smoked. And after the opera, he always came up to my apartment, and he left matchbooks. And I, because he smoked, and I took the matchbooks, and I put them in a drawer in my coffee table. And so I had this coffee table in my New York apartment. And the first time that I saw Jim Kerr, I thought, gosh, he looks like Clifton Webb. It reminded me of Clifton Webb. And Cliff had died. But this young man was closer to my age. Whenever I went out with Cliff, I was out with an older gentleman. And I couldn't say that of Jim Kerr. So.
Now, you shared something in common. You both like cooking, right?
And yes.
Wasn't that a way that you kind of got started?
Well.
Doing things together and music.
The first time I really thought he was interested in music was we met at this dinner party. And then a few nights later, I used to go every night for 4 hours to practice on the concert grand, because here I was teaching all day, and I liked to keep learning new things, and it was my privilege to have the key to the concert grand piano and practice on stage. All I had to do is turn on the light, open up the piano, and I was in business. So I did that every night. And one time I had the feeling that I was being watched. I looked to the right, and there in the hall was sitting this new young man whom I had met, James Kerr. And he said, "Now I know what you do. I've been trying to get you every night of the week and you're never home." So I had this gentleman friend. He asked me if I was interested in going to hear the string quartet play. "Oh, sure," I said. So we started going to things together. Now, he was younger than me and was good looking. And I thought, how nice to have a colleague who's good looking and, you know, and knowledgeable, liked music, had his own things to do. And we became friends. Then he invited me to dinner, and I accepted. I said, "What time would you like me to come?" And he said, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I said, "To dinner?" He said, "Well, we have to make the dinner. The best restaurant in this little country town was like McDonald's." And he wasn't going to take me to dinner at McDonald's. So we had to cook for dinner. We had to just, my husband had a feeling that anybody who can read can cook. He used to say that all the time. So we had a number of good cookbooks. First thing we had to do is decide what we're going to cook. Then we have to go out and buy the ingredients. Then we have to come back and we have to cook it. And then we can have dinner. And then we can talk, listen to music. And then he'd take me home. And that's the kind of date that we used to have.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. All right. Let's go on, but I wanted to hear, because that was something that was so important in your life in terms of your Edwardsville years, was meeting Jim and, spending so many years together as husband and wife. You know, that's awesome. Beautiful. Okay, another thing that I thought would be of interest is that in 1985, a small group of faculty and administrators from SIU Edwardsville went to China, and you were one of them. So yes. This was the notice in the Observer newsletter at that time. So can you tell me a bit about your experience there in China?
Well, We were sent to Hangzhou, China, on an exchange basis. They sent some people to our campus. I think it was four that were chosen. I was one of four. Dr. Ho was a mathematics professor. He was my special friend, and he was one of the four who went there to China at that time, too. And an important part, because he spoke Chinese, he was Chinese. And I think there was Dr. Pearson, and he was, philosophy professor. And I'm still in touch with Mary Pearson.
His wife, yeah.
Yes. So we four, we went to China in there. I remember this particular gentleman. The first time that I went up for rehearsal, I went up to his podium, and I said to him, "Maestro," and he said, "Don't you call me maestro." So, what can I call you? He said, "Call me comrade."
Oh.
And so it was a real, genuine communist China conductor. And it was such fun working with him. And at that time, the Chinese were just getting back into culture. For a long time, they did not have an orchestra that played, really, truly played concerts regularly. And they all had to be coming back again to their music. They loved their music, and they came back to their music. And we played a concerto together. What was it? A C minor Beethoven concerto, I think we played together. And I think that somewhere there must be a recording of it that SIUE might have of the program that we played together.
I'll have to take a look and see if that's among materials we have.
Yeah, well,
in the collection.
Yeah.
So I have another picture here of a
recital. Yes, here I'm playing the Chinese girl giving me flowers. It's sweet. Yeah. It was new for them to have a foreign artist play in Hangzhou Teachers College. And it was new for me to be playing there. It was a marvelous experience. I never thought I'd go back to China again, but I did. I did, and the Chinese are a wonderful artistic audience. They love the fine arts and music. They have a special feeling for the arts because of their ancient ancestry. And they have an artistic history that's very wonderful.
So just 2 years after that trip to China, you were retiring from full-time teaching and concertizing. And looking at some of your materials, you were very, very active in performing and teaching and writing.
Yes,
it was a busy time. So you and John Kendall both retired the same year at the same time, I understand.
Yes.
And I recall I was there. So for someone who was just a young incoming faculty member, it was really wonderful to see the tributes that were being made at that reception for your retirement that year. So you didn't stop there. So after you retired and were then an emeritus professor, you continued to perform. And I know that Dr. Alan Ho helped, the musicologist, and good friend of ours, helped organize this series of recitals. And this was a very ambitious recital as well. I mean, there were over four different recitals. You performed all this Chopin and
yeah, look at that. That's a good program.
Yes, and I remember my mother came from Michigan to hear one of those programs, and she was delighted. She's a pianist, was a pianist also.
Yeah, look at that program.
Great.
And then you also had some recordings made as well during that time. This one was released in 1999, the Ivory Classics. Do you want to say anything about this? Because Earl Wilde was associated with the Ivory Classics.
Yes, I made several recordings for Ivory Classics at that time. I think that this is a Schumann. Yes, it's an all Schumann.
That's right.
Yeah, well, I recall it because that was my sweater girl picture. I'm wearing a sweater.
It's a beautiful sweater. I love the color.
Thank you.
All right. And here, finally.
There's my husband.
Yes, this is later in life, but what a wonderful photo, happy photo. And
yeah.
This was with, actually, I think related to the St. Louis Symphony, some event with the St. Louis Symphony originally. Okay, and then I don't have much more at this point, but then you were also given an award, Lifetime Achievement Award, which I don't know if I can zoom in on this at all. I may not be able to, but that was in 2001 that you were given a Lifetime Achievement Award.
I don't even remember.
Yeah. Well, you had a lot going on at that time, and your husband was not well at that time. You were quite concerned about his health and well-being at that point in time, I remember. Yeah. But at any rate, so it's a beautiful, what a beautiful accolade to have, memento from the Regional Arts Council here in St. Louis. Yeah. Okay, other things that were happening, one of your international students, Zhang Tingwang from Taiwan, translated your book, Music at Your Fingertips, into Chinese. Mm-hmm. And I love this quote that you that you included as a preface. You say, this book is mostly for the developing pianist. It deals with the matters of how to practice in order to obtain maximum results. Without good practice habits, there cannot be achievement. With secure, steady, goal-oriented practice habits, there is no limit to discovering how far you can succeed. I love that. Success is possible, but it takes practice and it takes steady work.
That book was written, Music at Your Fingertips, was all written above the earth in airplanes. Because whenever I took a trip to play concerts, I'd travel in the air and I'd write a chapter or so like that. And the whole book was written up in the air. And the pictures were taken by a photographer in Argentina.
Really?
Yes.
Okay. I didn't know that.
Well.
Now, your 80th birthday was a big year for you because you were performing quite a bit yet, and you decided your 80th year you were going to go out with a bang, I think. So, well, we here at the library did a display in honor of you. Here's the Mississippi River Festival program, and here is them and you, your books, and just an array of materials. And you went ahead and did a program with three piano concertos on the same program. The Liszt Piano Concerto Number 1. You see that?
That's a big program.
Yeah. Not many people would take that on. And that was in Huntsville, Alabama.
Oh, my gracious. Well, in those days, I'd take on anything, I guess.
And see, by then, okay, so in 2002, okay, your husband passed away in 2001, March. Mm-hmm. And I know that was devastating to you. It was very devastating. So you went back to New York for a bit, but you were offered artist in residence position at Soochow University in Taiwan, which you accepted. Mm-hmm. And while you were there, you went to hear a Japanese pianist perform, and there was someone in the audience. You want to talk about that a bit? What that led to?
I don't.
Bonshu Mifune was in the audience.
I don't know that.
All right. Well, he's written about it, and it was at that concert. He didn't know you. It was like a private concert that another pianist was giving from Japan, and you were in the audience, and someone recognized you there in Taiwan, and they asked if you would play something, and you were a little reluctant. They said you said at that time, but you did. And Bonshu Mifune was so impressed by you, he came up afterwards and said, "Have you played in Japan?" And you said, "No." And he said, "Would you come?"
I know that. That's because I had a toothache, and I asked one of my friends, who's a good dentist here, and she said, "My husband is a dentist." And so I went to him, and he worked on the tooth that was bothering me, and we became friends. And then he and his wife and family would have me over to his house once in a while for dinner. And one time his brother visited, and
his brother was
Mifune.
Okay.
From Okayama in Japan. And he said, "You're such a great pianist, how come you never played in Japan?" I said, "Nobody ever invited me. If I invite you to come to Japan, will you come?" And I said, "Sure." So next thing I knew, that spring, he invited me to come to Okayama to play. And that's how I made my debut in Japan.
And it was a beautiful time of year when you came, wasn't it?
Yes, it was a spring in Japan, and I saw the cherry blossoms. And spring is perfectly gorgeous in Japan. It's an experience to see. Just to take a walk along the water was a beautiful experience because the pink cherry blossoms on top of the trees and the water below was all pink and green. Very beautiful, very beautiful.
Well, I recall that they even placed a beautiful piano under a resplendent old cherry tree, and you gave a recital or a concert outdoors, didn't you?
Yes, that was an exciting experience. People came from all over because this was a famous tree. It was one of the oldest cherry trees in Japan, and it was centuries old and huge and still producing. And so it was a famous tree. It was sort of on a hill. And so they brought kind of a stage, they put together a stage, and they brought a piano and put it on that stage. And next thing you know, I had a concert there. And went down from the hotel, and I saw my picture on the front of a magazine. And I have that front of a magazine. I was a
cover girl.
Cover girl in a Japanese magazine. So on account of that concert, that was really quite an experience.
I bet. Well, we don't have a lot of time left, so why don't we go ahead? But I will say that that was a fortuitous visit because you returned for every summer or every year for through 2010, just about every year. And Bonshu Mifune recorded and produced a number of CDs called The Art of Slenczynska, Art of Ruth Slenczynska, which are still available for purchase, although through their website. So I mentioned before, most of these images and materials are from the Ruth Slenczynska collection. This is the set of materials that you donated before you retired. Mm-hmm. And then you donated another set in 2002, which was quite large. when you moved, when you left from the Edwardsville area and moved to New York City again. So we very much appreciate that. And here are some images from our another part of that website. And I just wanted to say that also that Dr. Alan Ho created a discography about the performances that you've given and also the recordings that you've done. So that's available from our, the Ruth Slenczynska Collection website. I also have created a LibGuide called a Research Guide. And if people want to see some recent videos, they can go to this LibGuide. It's also a way to contact me, but then if you click on the videos tab, you'll see some recent ones that I've selected, but they could go to YouTube as well and find many of these days. So it's wonderful with this media that you're sharing some of your performances and your recollections of the past through a variety of these streamed videos and shared videos, including more recent performances. This was something from the past when you were in Japan, some reviews. But you did, it was a while since you, it took a while before you returned to SIUE as a visitor, as a guest to perform, because you had been in the St. Louis area in 2003, where you performed the orchestra there. But in 2010, you returned. And it was a very special occasion because since then, the university acquired a brand new Steinway Concert Grand piano. And you came and dedicated the recital to the memory of your husband, your late husband, Dr. James Kerr. So the very first thing you played was Liebeslied Widmung, from Schumann. So do you want to say something about that selection or that time?
I'm looking at the program. That's an interesting program. It has a little bit of everything in it.
She wonders why you chose that piece.
Well, Widmung means dedication. And I mean, this is a dedicatory concert. It's dedicated the piano in memory of my husband. And Widmung was a piece that Robert Schumann wrote for his wife's birthday. And Clara Schumann was a great pianist. She was the greatest female pianist in Europe at the time. And he wrote this piece for her. It was a dedication. And she said, oh, I love this. I've got to take it on my next tour. She said, why don't you fix it for piano? Because it's a song. And he said, I don't have the time right now. I'm writing a symphony. He said, why don't you take it to Franz Liszt, who was their friend, and he'll fix it for you so that you can take it on tour. And that's exactly what happened. He took Widmung and made it into a piano piece so that it is Schumann Liszt. And that's how I began this program.
Which I think was a beautiful, beautiful way to start that whole.
I think that I have recorded that, I think.
Well, actually, it was recorded by the university and was video recorded. And we have copies of that DVD available also from the Ruth Slenczynska Collection. So anyway, yeah, if anyone's interested, please let me know.
Oh my goodness, look at all those wonderful friends of mine.
Yes. And so at that concert, a number of your former students did attend the concert. And after the recital was over, they were invited to come up and they gathered and had this opportunity to have this photo taken with you. Okay. So, yeah.
You can see them. It's marvelous. Yeah.
So, okay. The next day you came back to the library and you did a lecture. This is you and me at the time. You did one of your lectures about talks about various notable composers, conductors, musician friends, dignitaries, telling some of those stories. And it's not the only place that you've shared that program, but it's a marvelous program. Both were younger then.
Yeah.
So you told about Samuel Barber. You told about Isaac Stern. You told about President Harry Truman, which we have their other accounts recorded of that. Your friendship with Vladimir Horowitz. And he was a neighbor of yours as well, I understand, right? Somewhere in New York City.
Yes. This is Vladimir Horowitz, yes.
Yeah. And then in 2018, you returned to SIUE again at the invitation of another former student of yours, Dr. Randall Pembroke.
At that time, he was the chancellor of SIUE. That's Randall Pembroke and his wife, Mary Jo.
Yes.
And they did a party for me afterwards. It's lovely.
Yes. So this was in January of 2018, just shortly before your birthday that year, and before your 93rd birthday. And this was the day that you arrived, and you have a routine of going and practicing, getting as much time in on that actual instrument you'll be performing on the recital. You did give a recital the next day. And it was a cold winter day, so you're wearing the sweater here. But then the day of the concert, in your usual way, I love the fact that you share stories with the audience of what you're going to perform and what you think of as you perform a particular number. And you still do that. I think it's really helpful to the listener to understand better what you're performing. And then we couldn't let you leave without a birthday celebration, which the Pembrokes did in their home.
Beautiful time. It's beautiful.
Okay, and as part of that visit, then I pulled out some materials, and with some of my colleagues, we organized an exhibit, which you did come and see, which it was great. And then some of your own relatives were here too. Your nieces were here with their families. Family members, that was a nice time. This is the other side of that exhibit, and since then, more recently, now I think you were planning to go back to Japan again. I know, in 2020, when. And you made it as far as California. You were staying with another friend, another former student of yours, right? And then what happened? Pandemic hit, right?
Well, COVID hit.
Yes.
And the plane stopped going to the Far East. It was dangerous at that time. It could not. Just like now, if I wanted to go to the Far East, I could not. I can't live in my own apartment now because New York is a dangerous place to live. And so I'm staying in Pennsylvania. I'm the guest. I've been a guest for 2 years now in central Pennsylvania with one of my former students, Dr. Moorman Stallman.
And what a blessing. I mean, and I know you were preparing a number of sonatas, Beethoven sonatas, for another anniversary year of Beethoven. You were going to perform it in Japan. And what did you do instead, since you were there with the students, the other students' place in California at that time? You recorded them. They were video recorded, right? And then they were posted. They are posted on YouTube. I also have them on my LibGuide.
Well, I'm always playing. My whole life is a life of playing. I just don't anymore. I'm 97, and I feel that I have done enough playing. I Exactly.
But you're also, I also appreciate that you've shared so generously your performances, not maybe of a large concert anymore, but some of these shorter recitals. So those four Beethoven sonatas were shared with all of us because you were willing to share that. And I know with Dr. Norman Stallman, Shelley there, you continue to do some performing and those have been shared as well. So thank you for that. That's another gift that you've given in recent years. And maybe looking at this picture makes you tired. I don't know. This was the re-release set of the American Decca albums that you recorded in your in the 50s and early 60s, reissued by Eloquence.
I think I recorded something that will be issued shortly.
Yes. Here we go. Perfect segue. So this is the new album. About a year ago, you recorded a new album for Decca. And it's coming out this Friday, March 18th. How exciting. So go ahead.
It has some things on it that I'd played before and some things on it that I didn't record before. It has a number of Rachmaninoff things on it. It has Chopin. I don't think I ever recorded the Fantasy of Chopin before.
No.
I don't think I recorded the Berceuse.
The new work, Barber.
Or the Barber. So there are a lot of things on it that I recorded for the first time that will be on this recording.
Wonderful. Well, we're almost near the end. We're at the end of my presentation. There might be some questions afterwards. I don't know. But I just wanted to end on this note. Just watch.
Oh, look at the flowers.
That was from your last recital here. I said, Brava, Ruth Slenczynska. May you visit SIUE again soon.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks for all you do, have done. Thank you. And the gift of your performing, your teaching, your writing. You're quite an ambassador for music. And we look forward to seeing you again soon. If not in person, via Zoom, I presume. Do we have any questions that were sent?
So I'm in chat. We've had a number of people joining us and some have joined recently. So if you have joined the program, the presentation, somewhere in the middle or recently, this will be archived and saved on Facebook. You can watch the entire thing later. And then if Therese and Ruth are on board, we could also upload that to YouTube for anyone that would rather watch there. I should say it's been a treat listening to the two of you share your memories and stories and reminiscing. It's been wonderful to sit in on this. Deborah Franklin, she in chat was saying that she remembers having a class with Ms. Ruth in the 70s. Deborah was at SAUE from 74 to 82. She may have had a different last name at the time, I'm not sure. But she wanted to share that. And as far as questions, there's just been a lot of people coming in. I had a question regarding near the end of your concertizing period when you were told to take rest due to your ulcer. Was that the longest? Was there any injuries that you had that caused you to have to stop playing altogether, whether it be wrist or hand injuries or anything along those lines?
Excuse me?
Did you have any hand injuries?
No, I never had a hand
injury.
I'm a very lucky, lucky lady. I never had a hand injury. Moreover, I can truthfully say I've been blessed with, I never had arthritis. I never had rheumatism in my hands. So many ladies my age complain of stiffness I never had anything of that kind. So maybe that's the result of all the practicing that I did.
Keep those fingers moving.
And then I have another question as someone who's been in Edwardsville since the 90s. Did you ever find better restaurants than McDonald's in your time at Edwardsville?
Well, Edwardsville didn't have good restaurants in those days. So, but anyway, we learned to cook out of a book. My husband and I cooked all over the world. We had a good time together. But as I said, my time with my husband was the happiest part of my whole life.
That's great. I think that's all I have as far as questions in chat. Therese, do you have anything else that you'd want to go
over?
There's
something that you never mentioned at all, and I'm surprised because I think the audience would be interested. I had the good fortune, while I was in Japan, to have an audience with Her Imperial Majesty, and we became friends with Empress Michiko. And she's quite a good pianist, and we have played four hands on many occasions. And I had an opportunity to see and play with the new baby. He's the last time I saw him, he was 3 years old, the person who will be the future emperor of Japan. And he's just the most adorable little baby that you could imagine. The Empress and I were in the garden one time, and he was brought by his English nanny to where we were at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, where she sees him every day at that hour. And Her Majesty spoke to the little boy and said, "Want you to show my friend how you say, how do you do?" And this little tiny boy, 3 years old, tiny little boy, got out of his little walker that he walks in and put his hand on his heart. He bowed. He said, "How do you do?" Most adorable thing you ever saw. And that's the future emperor of Japan. And it was a unique experience. So I thought you'd be interested in that. You make wonderful friends when you're in music. And I think if there's no other reason in the world to become interested in the arts, that the friends you make through the arts give you a lot of interest for everything in life. It's a marvelous thing in which to become interested.
I know many of your students look forward to, I've spoken of doing, having reunions during the summertime when you were here. And I know, having experienced some of the Zoom calls in recent years, it's amazing. There are people from all over the globe, and there's just such a feeling of love and admiration and friendship that just, you can feel it, you know, and it's just people from, again, speaking different languages, different generations. It's really wonderful to see that. And, you know, wouldn't that be wonderful if that were, you know, throughout the world, you know, the ingredient for the antidote for what's happening in some parts of the world right now, unfortunately. But I don't want to end on that note. So Edwardsville, we've been fortunate to have you as part of our experience for since 1964. For about 40 years, and you know, with Zoom and other virtual means, we can keep communicating. And hopefully the opportunity will present itself so that you can come again and visit or return for a longer stay again. Jacob, do you have anything more that you would like to say?
I just want to thank you, Therese, for your presentation, and thank you, Ruth, for taking the time to join us this evening. And I know you're an hour ahead of us, and I know it's getting close to when you'd like to just go to sleep. So thank you. Thank you for staying up with us.
Well, you're a fine host.
All right. Well, thank you so much again for this opportunity. And thank you, Ruth, for sharing some of your thoughts, and Shelley for being there and assisting
great
as well.
For you.
And thank you for all you're doing as Ruth goes forward with this part of her career, musical career, which is still going remarkably. So I know we'll have more to hear about exciting things happening in the future through your efforts as well. Again, bravo, Ruth. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for listening. And for those who watch this later, thank you as well.
Thank you. Amen. All right, take care, everybody.
Bye-bye.